Hello gentlemen, welcome to today's discussion. Today we will be discussing about the boiler water and its characteristics. What is the meaning of the characteristics of the boiler water? Well, it is simply the properties of the boiler water it has and the properties of the feed water. That means the properties of the feed water which we are giving to the boiler and the water which is already present in the boiler and the feed tank. So as we can see that there are a number of components present in the boiler water apart from the water or the pure water. These are mainly the salts like the magnesium and calcium salts and the carbonates, bicarbonates and the hydroxides and the hydroxides of the heavy metals like the calcium and the magnesium. So it has been found that the calcium and magnesium, carbonates, bicarbonates and the hydroxides, they cause a major property of the boiler water, that is the alkalinity. So what is the meaning of this alkalinity? As the name suggests, it is the opposite of the acidity. That means the property of the boiler water which makes it possible to react with the acids which are either present from the outside water or by the contamination of the water by the system, or the acids which might develop inside the boiler system or the feed water system like the hot well tank or the atmospheric condenser. So it is very much essential for this alkalinity to reduce the acidity of the boiler water, because otherwise there will be corrosion due to the acidic nature of the water and the whole system including the boiler and the passages through which the water and the steam passes, it will get corroded and it will get damaged within a short period of time. So alkalinity is a good property which protects the boiler. So today we will be talking about the alkalinity of the boiler water and how to maintain it so that the water remains in a healthy condition. Let us see what tests we have to go through so that we can find out the alkalinity of the water. Alkalinity of boiler water. We have to go through the test. Before going over to the test, let me just tell you that the test that we are going for is to find out the presence of and find out the amount of the components like hydroxides. Carbonates and bicarbonates of heavy metals like calcium and magnesium. Because these three are mainly responsible for giving the alkalinity of the boiler water. So the test for the alkalinity of boiler water is to be done in the two steps. Firstly, we have to go for one test that will determine the hydroxides and the carbonates. The second test, it means the total test, that means the hydroxides, carbonates and the bicarbonates. Number one is test. Tests are done by the way of titration with the help of some indicators and acids. So here in the P alkalinity test, we are using phenolphthalein as the indicator. So the P comes from the first letter, that is phenolphthalein. So it is called the P alkalinity test. It is done to find out the alkalinity due to the hydroxides and the carbonates. Whatever things are required for the test, that is the water sample, indicator, and the acid with which we are going to titrate. Because we have already said that the alkalinity is the property of the water to neutralize the acids. So we are using the acid and trying to find out as to how much quantity of the acid the water is able to neutralize. So we are using the acid. Here the acid used is sulfuric acid, H2SO4, with a strength of N by 50. The collection of sample is not taken from just any point as we wish, because if it is done in that way, then the proper readings will not be found out, which will result in different reading of the alkalinity, and also it might give some deposits or some more values of the reading. So the boiler supplier of the boiler has given a point called the sampling point. It is called the selenometer cock. So at that point, the exact values of the salts and the alkaline components are found out. So how to take the sample? Firstly, we have to blow through the sedimentary pump so that any sediments or deposits that are present in the cup, that will be washed away. And then the bottle which we have taken for collection of the sample, that has to be rinsed. So after rinsing the bottle, the sample is to be collected. And one thing to be noted is that sample has to be collected to the topmost level. Why? Because there should not be any chance of mixing of the atmospheric gases like the carbon dioxide, which might change the test values of alkalinity. So after taking the water up to the top level, the cap should be and the sample should be retained and kept up to some time for it to cool down. The first test is the P alkalinity test. It is done for hydroxides and carbonates. Now very soon we are going to know how much of these are neutralized in the first test. The procedure for the test is, firstly we have to measure out about say 100 ml of sample and put it in a conical flask. To this, add 2 to 3 drops of indicator, the phenolphthalein indicator. 2 to 3 drops of phenolphthalein indicator. After adding 2 to 3 drops of phenolphthalein indicator, if there is alkalinity in the sample, then color of this mixture, if it is alkaline, then color will turn to pea color. So when it is turning, when it is changing to pea color, we have to understand that it is alkaline. Phenolphthalein is a weak acid. So after that, what we have to do is that we have to drop by drop, we have to add the acid, sulfuric acid, drop by drop to the mixture of sample and the indicator. And we have to keep stirring or to keep mixing the mixture and keep an eye on the color of the mixture. Initially it is pink color and we have to keep on adding the acid, and what happens is that the hydroxide ions, they combine with the hydrogen ions of the acid to form H2O. That means the hydroxides are completely neutralized. And the carbonates, what happens? They form after combining with one hydrogen ion, they form bicarbonates. That means one carbonate ion has combined with one hydrogen ion, to again form the bicarbonate. One bicarbonate. That means the this much bicarbonate is present, which is to be neutralized in the next test. That means only the 50% of the neutralization has been done in the first step, that is the p-alkalinity test. So we have to note down the amount of the acid added to, and how to know at what time we have to stop the adding of the acid. As we can see that upon adding the acid at one point, the pink color disappears and the solution becomes colorless. Then adding of the acid is stopped and the final reading of the acid is to be noted down, and the initial minus the final reading is taken, and the volume of the acid is to be noted down, which is added in the first test. Volume of acid in p alkalinity test, let's say it is V1. So what is this? How does this V1 give us an indication of the p alkalinity? By the formula of the chemical analysis, we know that N1V1 is equal to N2V2, where N1 is the strength of the acid and V1 is the quantity of the acid added in milliliters, and N2 is the strength of the water, and V2 is the quantity of the water, or the quantity of the water sample. N1 is 1 by 50, as we have taken N by 50 H2SO4. So N1 is 1 by 50 and V1 is the volume of the acid added in the first step, is equal to N2. N2 is the, it is to be found out, and V2 is 100 ml. That is, N2 is equal to V1 by 50 into 100. This is the strength of the water. And what is the alkalinity of the water? Strength of the water and equivalent weight of CaCO3 into 1000. You give one upon 50 into 100. Equivalent weight of CaCO3 is 50 and again by into 1000. V1 upon 10 or 10 V1. ppm of CaCO3. So that is, p alkalinity is due to the hydroxides and the half of the carbonates. Alkalinity due to the hydroxides and half of carbonates.